it's time to look at the rule of elbows for shields. When we talk about an elbow shield, basically what we're talking about is we're talking about taking the reflex, the grasp reflex, one of our most primal reflex, the desire to reach out, clutch, grab, and stop whatever's in front of us. And we're taking that reflex and we're turning it back onto our head. If we've ever seen people, and the best example I can give you are any of the first three or four UFCs where you had style against style and people grossly mismatched with no ground training, you see them get dropped onto their back and start to have punches rain down on them. They had no response because all of the mobility and the blocks that they were used standing had no application on the ground. And what you saw was a lot of desperate mad reaching up to the face, which did nothing to block the incoming power of the strikes, and the punches would invariably go clean through and land on the subject. And that's a good example of the flinch overriding the subject and an ancient reflex not helping you. Because again, reflex, as I've said in many other productions, is not necessarily the best response in any given situation. It's simply that response which served the majority of the species, the majority of the time, in the majority of circumstances. Doesn't mean it's going to be the best thing to do right now when somebody's swinging a punch at your head. So if I want to avoid reaching for a knife, reaching for the origin of a punch, the best way to do that is to take that grasp reflex and turn it back on my head. When I have enough time and enough distance to see what's coming, the higher the level of my training, the more able I will be able to see aggression and movement cues. The sooner I'll be able to see them, and the more accurately I'll be able to interpret them. So that means that the more I train, the more calmly I'll be able to stay within my cognitive zone, my zone of optimal performance, tapping and reaching at them. But if I get overwhelmed, no matter how good I am, if somebody gets that little extra bit in, and they're close enough to be within my reactionary gap, within that meter, in like 2.5 to 3 foot distance, at that point, nobody is physiologically able to authentically respond. I may have a trained reference, like a slip, 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 and a slide. I may have some kind of a response that I've highly ingrained into my nervous system, but I will not be able to authentically cross-reach and interpret what's coming. I'm going to be getting clipped and hit. So one of the best things to do there is to shield up, to temporarily survive, and get out as quickly as possible. So we need to have three components when performing that shield. The first is for that shield to be framed, which means the grasp reflex needs to be turned back onto the self. I need to confidently close the circuit of my frame, grab myself. If I do not, what's going to happen when I absorb that impact is the hand is at minimum going to receive double damage. Impact to the arm, possible damage to the fingers. More likely and more often than not, it's going to be damage to the face with the thumb or the fingers going into the eyes. And the shield itself will do very little to stop the incoming power. So I want to make sure it's solid and it's braced like a foundation. I want to have that on the head. So one, it has to be framed. Two, it should be mobile, meaning that I don't want to just freeze and close my eyes and hope you disappear. I would like to have it washing the head. And the reason for this is that it's going to be more likely to displace the incoming force. It's not a matter of guessing where he's going and trying to act specifically in response to what's coming. It's just a matter of remaining a moving target so that as it hits with that time on target, it's more likely to be displaced or washed off. And it's also going to make you more deceptive and harder to read as a target. So one, it's framed and on the body, but two, it's always rubbing and washing the head. And number three, I need to plunge. I don't want to stay there up high on my toes and have my shield up. No matter how much it moves, I'm going to be a vulnerable target, and I'm going to be exactly where he intended me to be, which means his timing and his targeting is going to be perfect. What I need to do when that shield comes up and is moving is I need to plunge inside it. I'm plunging inside of it like I'm verifiably hiding inside a tank. I'm going down and in. So now if I pull in Darren, if Darren gives me a slow shot, if it comes in, cross or jab, doesn't matter, I can use my shield. Here it's more forgivable now against a cross or a jab. Here even cross reaching, you'll get away with it because it's a temporary survival mode and I'm still covered on the power side. So if I did cross reach, I'd still be covered on both sides temporarily. But again, I need to make sure that I'm moving all the time, always having it up. Now, of course, elbow shields don't always need to come out of a double frame. There are three basic ways I can shield. I can have a double high frame, but I can also have a blended frame. And in a blended frame, the framing will come from having this on the hand, or the hand on the body, and the other hand on the head. And here I'm still gonna wash, but I'm gonna be very certain about moving my elbow. You watch the old fights of Joe Frazier, Frazier was a good example of somebody who would use that kind of a cross frame. So I can migrate now from a double high frame to a blended frame. With the blended frame, if he's aiming for the head, I have both arms to assist. I can work with parries and intermix them, and I'm temporarily surviving. I also have the option of a third frame, which is a double horizontal. Double horizontal is perhaps the least favorable standing. It's most often used by prison guards or interventionists that are, you know, using either a shield or oftentimes pepper spray because it can be good for relieving cross-contamination if spray goes in the face. It can be used in tight environments where there's a hand accessing a weapon, and it's very good when you're pinned on your back and you're getting punched from a mounted position or a cross mount, because oftentimes the hands are jacked up high and this comes up more naturally than this, in which case the arms are oftentimes too high. But in a double frame, if I was here, sometimes you will see people in a blended frame, they start to weather too much damage and they drive in here. Now the key thing about all of these frames is that I have to teach myself to be lethal in them and effective in them. I need to know that I have to be able to strike from all of these frames directly. So what we'll be looking at next is what tools fire most easily from those areas. Because if I go into these frames and then I'm required to bring my hands down to a default boxing position to throw a conventional cross, then I'm going to have a serious gap in my timing. So we're going to be looking at what tools fire immediately from these frames and how we can use them to be as weaponized as possible.